if you can pause for a little bit and stop thinking, if you can, about computers and coding and enjoy what I would like to be a more relaxed discussion presentation. I would like to start by acknowledging the support from Argonne National Laboratory for my research, and also University of Chicago and Northwestern. And would also like to thank Sony Pictures Television for producing what some people say is one of the best TV shows ever.
Here we are.
Just like you left it.
And where is your pretty wife?
She has other business to attend to.
Well, like I say to her, place sells as is. Understand?
Yes, I understand.
Good. Good. I don't want her coming back with more demands. She gave me hard time when we settled on price.
We're all on the same page, Bogdan.
Yeah. So, so this individual, Bogdan, the car wash owner, walks now the streets of Chicago. People stop him with exclamations, "Oh my God, oh my, Bogdan, I love the show. May I take a picture of you? My boyfriend or my girlfriend told me about this show. I didn't plan to watch it, but now I'm addicted. I can't get it." And there is a Facebook dedicated to Bogdan's eyebrows. Okay, I encourage you to check out. And a number of blog entries. I selected a few. Somebody thinks that he doesn't look like a happy man, fairly old, 60s. 60s is not very old. He's not old at all. I'm in my early 50s, let's say. He has a tumor. That's not true. His wife wants to move back to the old country. I don't think that's true. His mistress needs a new car. That is true. But, and you, hundreds of entries like that. People really think Bogdan is, the car wash owner, is a real person. They want to interact. Of course, nobody knows my name. Nobody stopped me until recently. "Hey, Marius Stan, I really like your work as a scientist, and by the way, I saw you in Breaking Bad." That happens, however, at scientific conferences, so I take some comfort with that. Breaking Bad was an extraordinary production with quite, I would say, tremendous resources in terms of funding, and also the quality of the people participating. The writers, they had more than a dozen writers, are some of the best in the field. And a good script is what makes a movie great and made this TV series great too, I would say. Here's an example for those of you who never had a chance to see how a movie script looks like. You see there are dialogue lines, what Walt needs to say. There are some instructions, guidance for the actors. Raise an eyebrow, sound sad. How do you sound sad? But you see, there is a description of the set. For example, a bushy eyebrowed man stands in the wipe down area berating an employee. So that would be me. We can't hear what he's saying, but fans will recognize him as Bogdan. So this is what we got a few days in advance of shooting a scene, then another copy the very night before shooting the scene, and with some corrections the very day right before starting to work. But we do have scripts in science too, don't we? I would say that the scientific method, in a more general sense, provides instructions about how to do science. Start with an observation, formulate a hypothesis, develop a model, make a prediction, see if your prediction matches reality or not. And if it does, with a happy face, communicate that verbally or in a journal article. If it doesn't work that well, go back to your hypothesis or change the model. And that works in theory, experiment, and computation. Otherwise, you can see theorists have way more fun than everybody else. So today, I'm going to focus on the computational aspects. And we do get even more detailed scripts about how to proceed, how to write good quality software, right, software engineering, how to do experiments. There are manuals, user's manual guide, user's guide, documentation, which I'm sure each and every single one of you writes religiously, right? Write your code and immediately put comments on documentation, right? I don't do that too often, but I think you do. Another thing we need both in science and art is a good team of people. We have colleagues, of experts, of friends, if you want. You cannot accomplish much unless you have good people working with you. Here are some of my friends, computational scientists at Argonne National Laboratory. I'm not going to name any of them. I don't want to discriminate. They are all very good in their field. Some of them are quite famous in their field. Some are on the verge of becoming famous. But it's a great pleasure to work with them at Argonne. There are colleagues that I have at other institutions, research centers. And here's a sample of the programs. And I'm going to use this slide to also acknowledge their contribution and thank them for helping me prepare this presentation. So at University of Chicago, for example, the Computation Institute, we have a collaboration using Swift for multitasking with Mike Wild. At Northwestern, Peter Voorhees and Chris Wolverton, we do work on predicting properties of materials at the mesoscale with Peter and at atomic scale, electronic structure, DFT calculation, quantum mechanical calculations with Chris. Elia Merzari and Alex Babko, some of you may know them, helped us with these NIMS that Paul mentioned, $25 million per year program modeling and simulation in support of nuclear energy applications. And then there is a Center for Hierarchical Material Design that I wanted to acknowledge, Ulle Heinonen at Argonne and Greg Olson at Northwestern. Finally, work on batteries. Argonne is famous for doing research on batteries. We have a leading lab in the field. So all these people are truly good, outstanding in their field, and it's a pleasure for me, and I always look for joining forces with such individuals. And I hope that in addition to everything you learn in this meeting, in this here, in a technical sense, in addition to that, you make friends and network and keep in touch with the people, with your colleagues and with your mentors and lecturers, because in the future, you will need their expertise and their friendship and their collaboration. But teams and good people, talented people, are required for making a movie or a TV series. So here are some pictures. You are not going to believe these. These pictures have been taken in a cemetery. We were there to see the last episode of Breaking Bad, the very, very last live, at the Hollywood Celebrity Cemetery. It was a very quiet neighborhood. On the lawn, they have a big screen on the wall, against the wall. And we enjoyed watching that episode together. This is the cast. You may recognize actors from the series. This is Vince Gilligan, which I like to call the genius behind this whole project. He created this project. He would work with the screenwriters every Tuesday, I believe, to develop the action and develop the characters. And he's the one that, in fact, hired me to work in Breaking Bad. So I owe him a lot. Bryan Cranston, outstanding actor. I became friends with him. I maintained that friendship by interacting with him rarely. And with my family, my son and my daughter, who are students in California, both of them. And I'm going to acknowledge my wife, too, Liliana. She's a scientist at Argonne. She's with us today. And because I'm constantly worried that I'm going to get the Academy Award Right. And I don't have a chance to thank her, so thank you, Liliana. So the family was very supportive. Bob Odenkirk, if anybody watches the spin-off, Better Call Saul, Jimmy Kimmel, others, it was a very nice evening. And again, reinforced the idea that having good team members, partners, is important for any project. What else? Tools. Do you think there are any similarities between the tools we use in science, computational science especially, and the ones they use in making a movie or a TV series? Yes, there are, right? Here's an example, and I welcome comments about other examples. This is Michael Slovis, an outstanding award-winning cinematographer, and also the director of that very episode from which I extracted the scene at the beginning of the presentation, episode 4 or 6. Michael Slovis is really fanatic about and selecting the right lenses and filters for his camera. Depending on the light intensity, about the environment, about the characters, the time of the day, some things in the morning, some in the afternoon. He likes to use lenses that can give the sharpest, most adequate light and image and picture in his movie. But we are using lenses too. If you think about these are computational multi-scale methods, computational methods. If here I have the length scale from nanometers, which would be close to angstrom, the distance between atoms, all the way to meters, and picoseconds, which I cannot even imagine. Right, and I mean 10 to minus 12 of a second. It's so hard. Microseconds, milliseconds, seconds. And this diagram, which is perhaps the thing that I'm most famous for in the scientific framework. People, again, don't know anything about me, but they refer to this is Marius's diagram. Nobody, however, wanted to take a picture with me because of the diagram. However, quantum mechanical methods, density functional theory, for example, molecular dynamics, interactions between atoms, phase field at mesoscale, evolving microstructure, thermochemical methods, finite element methods, quite spectacular simulations. I do practice a number of these, not all of them, mostly DFT, molecular dynamics, phase field, and finite element. But in my group, the large group of friends that I mentioned to you, we have assembled a good tool set using these methods. So, you know, if you want to look deep into the structure of an object, you can use these computational tools somehow the way Michael Slovis will use his lenses to look and zoom in and out in a movie scene. But we as scientists use the tools to understand what happens in nature and to make predictions about phenomena that we are interested in. And I'm going to give you an example of how scientists use, computational material scientists, in fact, use computational tools, lenses, to understand what happens with gallium. Gallium is a metal that has an interesting property. It melts at a very low temperature. It melts in your hand, actually. You can see the liquid and the solid forming. Everybody can tell with a naked eye there is liquid and solid. But the scientists will not stop there. We would ask the question, how does that happen, in fact? What's at the interface between the liquid and the solid? Can we predict what the melting temperature in different circumstances, for instance, at high pressure? Or what if we combine, mix this gallium with another element and form an alloy, for example? What would be that melting temperature? And to do that, we are going to use molecular dynamics. This is quite intensive computational tool. In this particular case, we were using Dynamo, but more recently, we're using LAMPS, developed at Sandia National Lab, that can run thousands, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of atoms. And you'll see how gallium melts, actually, in a way that you are not able to do with a naked eye. You see, the liquid, the more disordered atoms, they're all atoms of gallium. They're pink because of that day I thought pink looks good on black. So the solid, more ordered structure is here. A little bit of liquid to the right because I want to have the periodical boundary conditions. Look at the interface. It becomes more and more diffuse. The temperature is a little above the melting point. The solid fights for its life. It would like to stay structured and solid, but cannot do that. Somehow the neighboring liquid is invading the territory. It's almost like a war, right? A more powerful country, which is the liquid, is conquering the solid, the small enclave of ordered structure. And there is nothing the solid can do about it. It will turn into liquid all the way, liquid. So you see that somehow the computer and the software I was running enhanced my brain. What I was not able to do just looking at that experiment, I am able to do with a simulation tool and understand and maybe even predict how fast the melting will happen, at what temperature. As I said, what if I replace a few atoms with a different element? How will that change? It allows me to predict phenomena that I don't have necessarily access to in an experimental sense, and also to understand better, improve my understanding of what happens. Okay, so I'm emphasizing this because I think it's the main element that supports the fact that computational science is the way of the future. It will never replace experimental work. It will partner with experiments, enhancing our brain, improving our understanding, maybe narrowing down regions where experiments need to be conducted. And doing that, by doing that, it will save us time and money. Plus, it's so cool. I don't have to advocate this to you. It's so cool to be on a computer and play with this phenomena and see what's going to happen. Coordination is also necessary in both science and movie industry, in cinema. This is a call sheet. A call sheet is something we would get the evening before shooting a scene. And in this call sheet, every single character and actor will have an allocated time to go, for example, for makeup and hair. Bryan Cranston, playing Walt, has to be at 6:18 in the morning for show up for makeup. It's not tomorrow morning sometime, or tomorrow in early morning, or tomorrow around 6. It's 6:18 in the morning. He must be there. And at 7:18, Bryan Cranston had to be on set. Anna Gunn needed twice as much time for hair and makeup. Just an observation. And Marius Stan playing Bogdan, 8:30, 9:30. That was good. I could have a nice sleep. Even the berated employee, do you remember the one, had to be there at 6:15 to prepare to be berated. exercise. So everybody was... Everybody received a schedule that was pretty tight. I was impressed how these people, who otherwise you would think they are artists, they don't care about, they have a beer and write a script and then, No. They come together and have a very strict schedule for creating the movie. There is a difference between being creative as a person and creating something, making something. We do have tight schedules too, right? This is from your program. We are somewhere in here. And we will wrap up 9:15, 9:30. You see, it's not 6:18 a.m. Like, you know, we will wrap up whenever we can. And that makes science, being a scientist, so great, that you have some level of control over your time. Yeah? Have you thought about that? Yeah? It's a great perk we get from being scientists, that we have some level of control over our time. But we do need, and let me reemphasize this, say this again. We do need to be disciplined in the daily life if we want to be out-of-the-box thinkers and free-spirited artists or scientists. That's a lesson I've learned on the set, where all the light people and sound people and actors and producers would just show up at the right time and put all their energy into creating that scene. Now, we also need money. So we're going to collect now a small amount from all of you to sponsor this presentation. I'm just kidding. But we do need funding, right? For the research, we need money to conduct our research, to develop, to work on the programs. We need money to build the facilities, to create the computers of the future, right? To pay the people, for them to focus and concentrate on their work. And of course, in Breaking Bad, no spoilers, but for those of you who saw episode 402, Bogdan received, a financial offer from Skyler, played amazingly by Anna Gunn. And he replied to that offer saying, oh, I want $20 million. And that was, again, the subject of some blog activity. Why $20 million? Why was that? And you know, I'm a scientist. So to me, as a scientist, $20 million would be good. But I would care more of getting 20 million gigaflops, which it just happens to be what Mira, in general terms, is capable of doing. Here's another funny fact. The program I was leading in Washington, and I'm still the director of that program right now, is $20 million a year. So what I didn't get as a character in Breaking Bad, I didn't get to run as a scientist at the Department of Energy. So there is something magic about this number. All right. I'm going to administer a test. You guys had enough fun so far, so it's time to be serious. This is summer training school. So be prepared. No, this is no joke. So I'm going to grade each of you, send the grades to Paul, and see what happens. This test is intended to evaluate your interest, imagination, and affection in a very good way for computational science as opposed to mathematics or computer science. And here it is. The problem sounds like, given an object in a gravitational field, we make observations. I told you, the scientific method, observations. The experimental observations are represented by these disks. This could be, for example, distance on the floor. And this could be height. The object is in a gravitational field. The positions have been measured. One team develops model A, and using the least square method, evaluates a correlation between the experiments and the model, this model. So they think this model, this curve, represents very well the trajectory of that object. The correlation factor is 0.95. One would mean it's a perfect, the line goes perfectly through the center of mass of each of these disks. To the right, there is a different model, slightly different shape, different correlation. Goes very well in some parts, not that well in different parts. So through a show of hands, who thinks model A is the best model of the two? Okay, so I would say a dozen people. Who thinks model B is the better model? Again, so maybe 12 bet on model A, 14 on model B. The rest either know the answer or are not impressed by Paul and I giving you grading your This is entirely based on observation, and the models are being developed in an empirical way. We think of at a curve that will go through the points. But what if you look at the physics behind this phenomenon? The model to the left was the equation of a circle. And we'll although had the high, the best correlation factor, kind of implies that the object starts here. So if we extrapolate and then goes and turns around, that would be amazing if that would happen. Right? So if I would throw this thing, it will go around. Model B, that didn't seem to go that well through the experimental points. It's the equation of a parabola, which is backed by Newton's laws of mechanics. And the predictions are now making sense in a physical way. This could be the initial point on the trajectory, and this could be the final. What I'm trying to impress upon you is that using theory-based models as opposed to empirical models improves both of your understanding of what happened with this object and also the predictions you are able to make. So keep this in mind as some of you will use software that you develop or software developed by others to solve physics and chemistry problems that you must have, you better have, you don't have to, but you better have theory-based models to represent well reality. How do we know that the solution of that equation, of the equations we just adopted as a model, some of you who passed and chose model B would be happy to know that was the real solution. Everybody who failed and may get no dessert this evening knows that the circle was not the good one. Solution verification is a very important step for in evaluating the quality of the software used by a computational scientist. And as you know, I'm sure you have discussed this, it involves the precision and accuracy. We often don't pay much attention to precision, but we pay a lot of effort in improving accuracy, double precision, many digits to get the solution that has perhaps in our mind the best chance to match the accurate result. I'm going to give you an example, but not from science, from cinema, how a certain instinct regarding precision and accuracy can help an actor, not a scientist, to really nail down the solution to this very problem. This is from Alien Resurrection, Sigourney Weaver. Some of you are familiar with this. First and only take of throwing an object, so an object in a gravitational
take
field.
Will be come up.
She's calculating right now, I assume.
The hell are you?
Decided to go for model B. This is a famous scene because they didn't have to do any other takes. It just worked the first time around. Creativity. Everything I told you so far is important. Tools, money, people choosing a good model. But nothing would happen in the absence of creativity, of being innovative, of finding solutions that are not in the mainstream line of thought of the community. And actors and scientists differ in this respect. If so far I try to demonstrate that methods and tools and funding and are similar, now I'm going to emphasize a difference, which is I believe scientists create and communicate knowledge. We're interested in understanding nature, while artists are more interested in creating and communicating emotions. We go to a movie theater, you want to feel emotions. Art is in the business of creating emotions. Science is not. Emotions.
No. Come with me.
Thank you.
1942. Think about it. No computers. This was everything, the flames, the combustion, if you want, was created by hand. Hand drawing, thousands of frames, colored, drawn by hand by people. Isn't this amazing? Yeah. Things have changed with the occurrence of CGI, computer generated images. Anybody has an idea when that happened?
Terminator 2?
No. 1974, Westwood. Yul Brynner is playing a complex robotic character that has extrasensorial vision. And they needed the character to see a man on a horse on top of a mountain and didn't want to pay for a man and a horse to go on top of a mountain. So they created these pixels, colored pixels, that from a distance may look like a man and a horse on the top of a mountain. So that was the first occurrence of CGI, computers contributing to cinematography. This is a more recent result. I chose this because it's again about flames and creating emotions through, if you want, computational fluid dynamics would be our terminology. Big difference. I still like Bambi more for some reason. But you see, computers assist cinematography in a variety of ways. CGI is just one of them. We do have interest in computational fluid dynamics for scientific purposes, right? These are very recent simulations of cooling flow in a nuclear reactor. You need to cool the fuel elements. And the team was looking at the impact of the geometry of the inlets, hexagonal inlets, on the behavior, on the evolution of these two flow channels. And the right, the geometry to the right, in the panel to the right, the geometry was changed a little bit. And you'll see, this is all computational. In fact, high-performance computing, these have been run on the leadership class computer at computers at Argonne. You will see how the small change in geometry would make the channels to the right to mix and create a higher level of turbulence. You can see, right? So good coolant fluid, bad. Why is this important? It's important because to stop a reactor and change these things and play with them and restart the reactor and see what the influence is would be extraordinarily cumbersome, disruptive. In fact, would be financially a disaster. But we can do the simulations and see what is the best geometry, the optimal geometry that will create the type of fluid behavior that we would like to have. So computers, again, expand our brain and allow us to investigate a certain domain that is not inaccessible to our senses or even to experiments. Right? We can simulate the entire reactor blowing up. We want to blow up the reactor in order to understand what happens. We want evidence using computer simulations. So I'm saying this only to make you think about how you are using the software you create, you are creating, or the software you're using to enhance your brain. What can you access using the codes that you have and the platforms you have, the hardware you have, we don't have normally access to. We talked about a little bit about verification, making sure that our solution is correct. Precision, accuracy, number of digits. But is this real? Are the simulation, the models we are using, do they represent reality? That is perhaps an even more important question. Model validation deals with that. So you know that some people say verification is about solving the equations right. Validation is about solving the right equations. Indeed, for the very simulations, computational fluid dynamic simulations I showed in the previous slides, we have at Argonne an experimental facility where, using cameras and lasers, a group of experimentalists led by Steve Lomperski can evaluate the velocity field, the temperature field, look at characterized turbulence, and indeed determine if the simulations we carried on these big computers represent reality. But representing reality is not only of interest to scientists, right? I care that my simulations represent reality, but so do movie makers. And I hired a very famous director to explain that point of view.
What are you saying, Jake? You knew this would happen?
Because of the nature of this film, you know, with this alien clan, this alien culture, you know, we had a choice. We could do it with makeup, like it's always been done, you know, rubber appliance makeup. It would have looked horrible, and it would have been boring and stupid and, you know, kind of blue actors running around in the rainforest in their underwear, you know, and a bunch of blue body paint. It would look terrible. And I wasn't interested in that. You know, if I was going to do this, I wanted to do it this way, which is with performance capture.
But before he could do that, Cameron first had to make sure his technology could cross what's known in robotics and animation as the uncanny valley.
Let's say this is an absolute human. And this is a, you know, kind of a talking moose. You know, as you approach human, our attraction to the character goes down. And then at the last second, just when you get to a true human look, it goes back up. Well, we needed to get on the far side of that dip in the response curve, which is called the uncanny valley. And we needed to get to the opposite side where we believed. We don't have to necessarily believe that it's 100% photoreal, and we don't have to necessarily believe that they actually exist. But we have to believe in them as emotional creatures.
Now, as a scientist, I have experienced the uncanny valley so many times. While improving my model with adding more and more parameters, more physics, more chemistry, I was thinking I'm getting closer to representing reality. But it looked worse. At some point, it looked so bad that I was ready to give up. Now, I believe that neither scientist or cinematographers can reach a perfect representation of reality. I also submit to you that it is not desirable. There is some beauty in imperfection. There is value in having a model or a movie that represents reality very well, but not perfectly. So you also had a chance, I hope, to notice more science and technology being used in movie making in this video clip. You saw how intricate. By the way, the simulations were made on a, I would say, a rudimentarily assembled cluster of Hewlett-Packard machines. It took 10 years to make this movie. They started with what they had, very good machines, but maybe not the best, not one that you would design, I'm sure, following this training. And computers and technology and robotics play a role in making movies today. And I'm going to end with the other component of the value that science adds to humanity. The first one, again, was understanding nature, helping expanding our brain to help us understand nature. The second is to making predictions. I'm going to let you read this because it somehow goes back to the midterm test you had. And I can only agree with Steve Jobs that from time to time we should stop, try to understand what we just did or what we have been doing over the years, and then project and make a prediction for the years to come. Here is an example of somebody who was a visionary, in my opinion, and does not get enough credit for that. You all know about Moore's law, right? The transistor count doubles every so many years, and in a linear fashion, we expect more and more transistors to be packed. And in other words, the computers to be more and more powerful and
faster and faster. But if you had the interest and the patience, like I did, to find the actual paper, Electronics 1965, you will find this paragraph, which to me is something amazing that demonstrates how this man could see the future better than many others. I'm going to read this out loud. The future of integrated electronics is the future of electronics itself. The advantages of integration will bring about a proliferation of electronics, pushing this science into many new areas. Integrated circuits will lead to such wonders at home as home computers, again, this is 1965, or at least terminals connected to a central computer, automatic controls of automobiles, and personal portable communication equipment. The electronic wristwatch needs only a display to be feasible today. This was 1965. Of course, Moore did not think, predict that Aurora will be created in a few years and hosted by Argo National Laboratory. I don't think he thought all the way through exascale computing and what are the implications. But that doesn't prevent us from trying to make predictions. And it's not only about the CPU, it's about memory, about storage, information storage. Bill Gates bragging about the fact that a stack of paper, including, I believe, 200,000 papers, letter size or A4 size, maybe 250,000. The information in this stack of papers was then available on a CD-ROM. That was in 1994. Here is some information from a few weeks ago, 256 gigabytes USB flash drive by SanDisk. More information than I have on my laptop. I don't know about yours. Maybe you guys are rich enough to have solid state drives of half a terabyte, right? But memory storage is now available in a way that was inconceivable a decade ago. Here are my predictions. My predictions have to do not necessarily with how computation will evolve or experiment, but what we are likely to see over the next 5 years. I think that using computers and simulations, we will have energy production that is more environmentally friendly. So this figure doesn't say that we can buy our power plants at Walmart. It says it will be more environmentally friendly. Energy storage, I predict that if you buy an electric car 5 years from now, the battery will be changed much like a propane tank at one of the power stations that will double as a gas station. And that the battery will last 500 miles, much like a gas tank does. So work done at Argo National Laboratory, but in other places too, may lead to a higher density and faster charging, recharging type of battery that is not available today. I also think that digital manufacturing or 3D printing would be available at your grocery store, like your CVS or your Walgreens. You know, the way you select vacation photos and upload them to their website and then click print and then go downstairs or to the store and pick up the printed copies. I think if your mouse or microphone, for that matter, doesn't work anymore, you can just select a design from the web, send it to a 3D printer, go there, and get a brand new microphone. So printing objects is going to be available for consumers. But what interests me the most, and I think will happen over the next 5 years, will be that we will be able to create a huge database of not only properties or measurements, but also of models of materials that will allow us to select the materials of choice for any application we want. So if you want to think about this in a way that brings back memories from high school, I'm imagining a periodic table of elements that is not only about elements, it's about mixtures and phases and liquids and compounds and everything you can imagine. But you can query that table and get the properties of the material you want. This is sometimes called materials genome initiative. So these are at least four things that I think will happen in the next 5 years. Now, how about you? This is the final test. You had a midterm. You passed, most of you. This is the final test. For the test, I would challenge you to send me and copy Paul an email with what you think will be the top five programming models in 2020 by the number of users. What do you think that would be? Anybody could have a guess what a ranking would be today? I'm not going to tell you. I don't want to help you with anything. You are on your own. Research that. Think about that. And try to imagine. Why is this important? If you are right, you better start using and learning that model. You don't want to get to 2020 and see, oh man, nobody's using Java anymore, or nobody's using OpenMC. So please email me, and I'll talk with Paul and find a way of rewarding the most diligent and innovative and creative responses. So with that, I'm going to end expressing some thoughts about what you guys should do as you decide about your profession. And I'm going to use a language that you like, if-then statements, right? So if you like to create something, to be a creator, then you could be a writer or a scientist or an engineer or a composer. Now, another option is to serve society, very noble option. Can be, think of your teachers, your professors, the doctors, right? Firemen, pilots, soldiers, lawyers. I thought long about lawyers. I had politicians too, but after coming back from DC, I removed that. So you can choose something. Then maybe you don't want to create anything because you don't feel like, you don't want to serve society because that tends to be difficult. Maybe you like to tell other people what to do. This is based on my experience. So, okay. But whatever you decide to do, do it with all your heart. And with that, I thank you for your attention.
Sure, Marius would be willing to take questions. Sure.
Yes. Anybody has questions?
I was going to ask, what pays better, being an actor or a scientist?
If your question was about money, being an actor pays much better per day. So the compensation I received for a day of working as an actor was significantly higher than the one I received as a scientist. But then I am not an actor, and nobody, I guess, is an actor all the time. So overall, if you think of the whole year, in my case, being a scientist pays better to choose your term. Of course, it was perhaps not part of the question, but money is not everything. It's just one part of, as I'm saying, making friends, being creative. Those are hard to evaluate. But, so everybody who wants to be paid very well per day, go and audition. Go and audition, and that's really good.
I'm just curious, in your first slide, you showed that script, right? And it seemed as if it was written with a typewriter. So do they still use typewriters to type out scripts?
So the question was about the script I showed at the very beginning, and if they are using typewriters to prepare the script. No, they are not. But there are strict formats about how the screenplay should look like. They go all the way to what the margins have to be, what type of font, what size, but they are all generated on a computer right now. If you are interested and passionate about writing screenplays in general, there is software dedicated to that, that you can buy and will format everything for you. But yeah, so the reason for doing that is such that actors are immediately familiar with the script of any script, and they don't have to, because some of them like to learn and prepare. They're method actors that prepare everything in advance, and it's good for them to have a format that is familiar rather than, I don't know, what calligraphy and images and.
Has high-performance computing led to a single event or a creation or whatever in the series Breaking Bad?
Not to my knowledge. I don't think high-performance computing in general was used. I don't assume, I don't know if anybody ever ran something on a big machine to help Breaking Bad. So if there is anything that could be related, it would be the chemistry in the show. But the chemistry in the show is totally wrong. Don't try to make methamphetamine by watching Breaking Bad. It doesn't work. So it looks right, but it doesn't work. Yes?
What would you say is the biggest challenge coming back to science from your other life?
So the question was, what I think is the biggest challenge for science in general, or for me as a scientist?
Yeah, like coming back to science.
Oh, returning.
Yeah.
I wasn't gone that long, in fact. So I was telling Paul and colleagues at the table that I've been in Washington, D.C. for a year and a half, which is about right. Being there less than a year is not sufficient to understand how the government works. Some people may say that nobody can ever understand how the government works. But a year and a half was about right. Staying longer would have created some issues. The field is advancing fast. If you are there 3 or 4 years, most likely you are not up to date with what happens. Plus, I had some colleagues, postdocs that I was supervising, and I had my scientific work that needed to be advanced. But so reinserting myself in the scientific community, it was not that big of a challenge, I would say. I have some ideas about what to do next. And I'm happy to report that during my stay in Washington, the United States government operated pretty well with me. So I'm really happy with that. Yes.
So your midterms seem to suggest that we should choose models with the best underlying fundamental physics in them. So you're really able to follow that approach when choosing a DFT functional?
When choosing the DFT functional, I do look at the physics. When I add the two fitting parameters in DFT plus U, I don't consider physics that much. So to be honest, in every model, there are some parameters that one can tweak or adjust. Now, that type of research is quite valuable in itself. It's often called assessment. You assess a system where you fit parameters to match reality. Assessments may not help you make predictions. That's why I'm striving, and my colleagues are striving, to use as much physics as we can, as fewer parameters as we can. But I cannot look you in the eye and say everything is from first principles. Actually, in my publications, I avoid ab initio or first principles because it's often an exaggeration. We are close to represent everything starting with first principles, with Newton's theory or Schrodinger's, but the reality is that our models are based not only on that theory, but also on our experience as scientists and what we know about the system. And sometimes some empirical parameters may play a very important role. There was another, yes.
Are you going to appear in Better Call Saul?
No, I had one conversation about this topic with Bob Odenkirk, and the only conclusion we could reach came from him. He said, a lawyer has to wash his car. So I don't know, if I get back my car wash, we might cross paths again. But I don't know anything for sure. I don't have any information. So I hope it will happen. Who knows? By the way, if you go to Albuquerque, you can visit the car wash as well as the White family home. They give tours. There is a whole industry based on Breaking Bad over there. So.